Last time, in our second section, we talked about limits and continuity, which gave us a great foundation for today's topic, derivatives. We'll be wrapping our heads around the first of two fundamentally important questions in calculus: how to find the rate of change of a function at a point. Before we go any further, let's talk about what we mean by the rate of change of a function at a point. We all know the rate of change of a line. It's just the slope of the line. For example, picture the graph of the function 2x plus 2. We can tell just by looking at the equation that the slope of the line is 2. And it doesn't matter where we are on the graph of the function, the slope is 2 everywhere. But what about this graph? What is the slope or rate of change of this function at this point, or this one? What if we need to know the slope at both of these points? How can we find the slope of a curved surface? Well, we don't really. We'll actually find the equation of the line tangent to the curve that passes through that point on the graph, because remember, we already know how to find the slope of a line. Let me take a half step back and talk for a brief moment about something I just said, the line tangent to the curve. What does it mean for a line to be tangent to a curve? It means that the line just barely skims the graph, intersecting it at exactly one point. Think of the tangent line in contrast to a secant line, which runs through the graph at one or more points. Now imagine a secant line intersecting the graph at two points. As I move this second point closer to the tangent point, the distance between the points of intersection becomes smaller and smaller, and the secant and tangent lines become more and more similar. Eventually, the distance between the points will become infinitely small, until eventually the two points come together at a single point, and the line no longer intersects the function at two points, but instead only at one. And this is the tangent line to the curve at that point. So, in order to calculate the rate of change of a function at a point, we need to find the slope of the tangent line, and therefore, obviously, the equation of the tangent line. How can we do this? Well, recall from algebra that in order to calculate the equation of a line, we either need two points or a point and a slope. Well, the slope is the very thing we're trying to solve for, so in order to find the equation of the line, we'll have to use two points. Well, we already have one point. It's the point where the function and the tangent line intersect each other. So we just need one more point. Which point can we pick? Well, since we currently only have one equation on the table, the equation of the function itself, we can only pick points on the graph of our function. So, let's pick another point on the graph, one that's relatively close to our tangent point. Using these two points, we can find the equation of the secant line that connects the two and use that as an estimate of the tangent line. But, of course, an estimate isn't good enough. We want the exact equation of the tangent line. To model this mathematically, we'll have to borrow an equation we learned way back in algebra for the average rate of change of a function between two points. A f of A is our tangent point, and B f of B is our second point. Using these two points, we can calculate the average rate of change of the function between them. Remember, though, that we're trying to find the instantaneous rate of change at the tangent point. So if we start moving B f of B closer and closer to A f of A, and we continue calculating the average rate of change between the closer and closer points, we'll start to see the average rate of change approach a specific value. The value it's approaching is the instantaneous rate of change, also known as the slope of the tangent line, which is the slope of the function at the tangent point. This brings us to the definition of the derivative. Let's modify slightly the formula for average rate of change. Instead of using a and f of a, we'll use x and f of x, and we'll call the distance between the tangent point and the secant point h. Now we can simplify the function by canceling x's in the denominator. Then, thinking about the tangent line and borrowing what we learned last time about limits, we can take the limit as h goes to 0, and this gives us the slope of the tangent line. In other words, as we bring those two points closer and closer together, h, which is the distance between the points, gets smaller and smaller until eventually it becomes zero. And then we have the slope of the tangent line, or the instantaneous rate of change of the function at the tangent point. Before we wrap up today, let's take a look at one example. The problem says we need to use the definition of the derivative to find the instantaneous rate of the function f of x equals x divided by the quantity 1 minus 2x when x is equal to 1. You can see that the definition has more or less two components, f of x plus h and f of x. We already have f of x. It's our original function. To calculate f of x plus h, we'll take all of the x's out of our original equation and put an x plus h in their place. Now we can take f of x and f of x plus h and put them both into the definition of the derivative. Now we need to start simplifying. The simplification process will be different depending on the original function. In this case, we have to find a common denominator in the numerator of our function. Eventually, once we've fully simplified, we'll take the limit as h goes to 0. In other words, we'll plug in 0 for h, and any term involving h will disappear from our derivative function. What we're left with is the derivative of the original function, which we denote as f prime of x. To find the slope of the function when x equals 1, we just plug 1 into the derivative function, and we see that the slope of the function is equal to 1. Or, put another way, the instantaneous rate of change of the function at x equals 1 is 1. Next time, we're going to expand on what we've learned about the concept and definition of the derivative to talk about some better techniques we can use to calculate derivatives. I'll see you then. Click on a video for a more in-depth look at the topics covered. Review this video by clicking the links on the right, and subscribe to be notified of future videos.